trust one another and look after one another.
So what did the Labour Party do to you?
Ruin my life. Politically, they tried to.
Ye are many. They are few.
We're totally f***ed. The party is about to be taken over by complete nutjobs.
Nobody can fail to see that this was a concerted, orchestrated campaign.
Senior officials in headquarters were actively working against Labour.
There is a secret key seats team arriving in Ergon House permanently.
All the apparatus was in the hands of these officials.
We can't see what we're doing with digital spend.
Diane Abbott literally makes me sick.
But I've never been in such a racist organisation.
Nazi apologies. Nazi apologies. Rewriting history.
This was part of the factional struggle to destroy not only Jeremy Corbyn, but the membership of the party.
And if you appease the right, if you appease a dangerous animal, the chances are you'll be killed. And he was killed.
Labour in Bristol has been shafted. It is no more.
Stronger out, socialist in.
I really believe he is as dishonest as Boris Johnson is, albeit in a less flamboyant fashion.
He'd worked quite closely with the CIA, hadn't he?
He is above all a servant of the state.
He's a dangerous, deceitful man who will do anything.
In 2017, the supporters of Jeremy Corbyn came close to putting him in number 10. But within 3 years, his party had been crushed at the polls, and Jeremy and his grassroots movement apparently dumped in the waste bin of history. What happened? What destroyed the Corbyn project? And has it been destroyed? When Jeremy Corbyn became leader of the Labour Party in 2015, it gave new hope to the left here and across the world.
When the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours, oh, one day.
He's a man who speaks a different language, and it's the language of peace.
Jeremy Corbyn's revived the Labour Party, he's reinvigorated the Labour Party, he's given it a purpose. Remember the old Harold Wilson dictum that Labour's nothing, it's not a moral crusade? It's true.
But I'm going to support Jeremy, as I've supported every single Labour leader since I joined the party in 1971.
Okay. Well, I think the Labour Party is either going to have a choice. It's going to have to think about moving swiftly against Jeremy Corbyn and putting this unfortunate episode behind it, or it's going to have to suffer in silence.
I think people have had enough of the politics of celebrity, the politics of personality, the politics of abuse.
Keep fighting, Jeremy. You're the best thing that's happened to our party in 30 years.
Thank you.
The Labour Party offered hope to millions, and 500,000 people joined, became Labour members. Biggest party in Europe on the left, and a really exciting time.
All over the country, we're getting these huge gatherings of people.
I was absolutely ecstatic. I mean, I've been aware of Jeremy for decades, and I knew what fantastic leader he would be.
They're young, they're old, they're black, they're white, all ages, many outlooks, many people who've never been involved in politics before.
it was an incredible feeling, and I guess I just remember feeling very, very hopeful at those times, and thinking that, God, we might now be in a party that is a genuine vehicle for radical change.
I was used to going to Spurs, and I could hear that as a football chant. The big Spurs man at the time was Moussa Dembele, and people used to say, "Oh, Moussa Dembele." And then I hear it on the train, and it wasn't Moussa Dembele, it was Jeremy Corbyn. And so there were youngsters who were taking it on and breathing life into politics.
But for the establishment, the sudden rise of Corbyn was terrifying.
Our job was to try and make the world a better place during our life, that our children's generation would have a better standard of living and more opportunities than we had.
Corbyn was anti-capitalist, anti-war, anti-nuclear weapons, a socialist even.
I haven't seen Malleys like that in my lifetime, and sadly, I don't think I'll see rallies like that again.
I guess that's what gave the establishment such a fright to a degree, because they saw the numbers he was mobilising. And as we began to see, it's not actually Corbyn they're afraid of. Corbyn's only one man. It's us they're afraid of.
Is there any moral basis whatsoever for holding and therefore being prepared to use a weapon of ultimate mass destruction?
For some, just the idea of somebody like him in Number 10 was a declaration of war.
General Sir Nicholas Horton says he'd be concerned that Jeremy Corbyn wouldn't be prepared to press the nuclear button if he were Prime Minister.
When you heard a general, a serving general, when Jeremy was first elected, going on the record saying that they will not tolerate a Corbyn-led Labour government cutting defence spending, scrapping Trident or withdrawing from NATO. And he went on to say, and we'll use fair means or foul to stop that.
But from the start, Jeremy Corbyn's biggest threat was from his own Labour MPs. Out of 230 or so of them, he could maybe count on around 30 to support him. Most were actively plotting to get rid of him.
They could rely, the establishment, on most of the PLP. They were going to do the work for them. There was no need for tanks on the streets or any of the very British coup scenario because, well, you know, in 2016, 80% of the PLP wanted Jeremy out.
The MPs resigned from his shadow cabinet. They passed a vote of no confidence in him. They supported a leadership challenge against him. Nothing worked.
I have just chaired a meeting of the Cabinet where we agreed that the government should call a general election.
Theresa May's snap election in April 2017 was like an answer to their prayers. Corbyn, they thought, would be totally slaughtered and gone forever. But things didn't go that way.
In unvanquishable number, shake your chains to earth like dew, that in sleep have fallen on you. Ye are many, they are few. Yeah.
How did you feel when you heard the result of the 2017 general election?
Absolutely amazed and really pleased. No one expected a good result, and it was a really good result for Labour.
Corbyn didn't win the election, but he got the largest increase in the share of the vote of any Labour leader since Clement Attlee in 1945. He robbed the Tory party of its majority in Parliament. The result sent shockwaves around the world. Most shocked of all were the Labour MPs who wanted Corbyn gone. The BBC caught their unguarded, on-the-spot reactions. It made great telly.
I was very shocked. I nearly drove off the road.
Oh, my God. What? Oh, that's unbelievable. A 30-seat game.
Yeah, you're looking at a hung parliament, then.
And they were shocked that their little plans, their coups, their leadership contests hadn't all gone to plan. And that is why, after the 2017 election, everything went into overdrive, because we were that close and that could never happen again.
We have to trust one another. Look after one.
The Tory press threw it all at Jeremy Corbyn. They tried smear after smear, but in the end, only one stuck.
There is a big lie everywhere, and one of the big lies of our time is the lie of Labour Party being infested with anti-Semitism.
They redefine anti-Semitism. They redefine it so that if you are critical of Israel, that is by itself anti-Semitic.
I was accused of anti-Semitism by my Tory MP for demonstrating outside an arms factory in my local town, Broadstairs, with the campaign against the arms trade. It happened to be Israeli-owned factory, and that was seen as anti-Semitic.
I doubt if there's a single Palestine solidarity activist in this country who has not been accused of anti-Semitism. Anyone who issues any criticism of Israel is, according to them, anti-Semitic. Because they redefined anti-Semitism. It's not opposition, it's not hatred or hostility to Jews as Jews. For the Zionists, anti-Semitism is opposition to a Jewish racial supremacist state.
For years, Corbyn had spoken up for the Palestinians and condemned Israel's illegal occupation of their country. His enemies now put all this down to a hatred of Jews.
Many Corbyn supporters would deny being anti-Semitic, but would admit to being anti-Zionist. What's the difference for people who don't really know what this is all about?
Well, anti-Semitism is the hatred of Jewish people, and anti-Zionism is the fight against a colonial settler state which is oppressing a people, the Palestinians. It's all the difference in the world.
To be an anti-Zionist is to actually be an anti-racist. You know, Zionism is fundamentally a racist ideology.
Now, of course, Jewish people who have gone to live in Israel have the absolute right to continue to live there. But I think that Israel, Palestine, should be a state of all its citizens and not a state that gives priority to only one part of its citizenship.
You can dress it up however you like, but Israel is actually a Jewish separatist state. That's what it is. Full stop.
A number of organisations have defined Israel as an apartheid state, and I oppose Israel as an apartheid state in a very similar way to the way that I opposed South Africa as an apartheid state 40, 50 years ago.
The anti-Semitism smear hurt Corbyn, but it didn't take him down. Others were smeared too, most famously Ken Livingstone.
He never went into the studio to talk about Hitler. Vanessa Feltz asked him about Hitler, and he cited the Havara Agreement, which was an agreement between the Nazi regime and the German Zionists with a view to relocating German Jews into Palestine. That's a matter of historical fact. And for that, he was accused of being a Nazi apologist by that thug, John Mann.
You're Nazi apologist. Rewriting history.
Who should have been suspended. Action should have been taken against him. Indeed, I think police action, frankly, it was an appalling assault that he engaged in. I mean, he didn't lay a hand on Ken, but he wasn't far short of doing so. Very, very aggressive, hectoring assault that he waged against Ken, and no action taken against him.
But the smearing didn't stop with Livingstone. Some of Corbyn's most radical supporters came under fire and were forced out of the party.
Were they anti-Semitic?
No, I was one of those as well. And all of us in different ways have spent our lives fighting racism. So this was part of the factional struggle to destroy not only Jeremy Corbyn, but the membership of the party.
But how did it feel when you were first seriously accused of being anti-Semitic?
It was a huge shock. You know, if you're both black and Jewish and you have actually experienced not just bigotry, not just name-calling, but actual physical attacks because of the colour of your skin, your ethnic group, whatever you want to call it, then when somebody does that to you, it undermines absolutely everything that you've based your life on. It was absolutely dreadful.
Nobody who has followed it reasonably closely, nobody can fail to see that this was a concerted, orchestrated campaign.
But if it was an orchestrated campaign, who was in the orchestra? Israel lobby groups were prime candidates, of course. But a documentary produced by Al Jazeera said even Israel itself was in on the act.
One of Israel's main targets is the Labour Party. For the first time, its leader is a champion of Palestinian civil rights.
They'd be very happy to see Jeremy Corbyn no longer leader of the Labour Party, for sure.
It's a covert action that penetrates the heart of Britain's democracy.
Can I hear some of that would suggest that you would take down?
It is outrageous interference in British politics. It shouldn't be permitted.
I saw Jackie walk around Saturday and thought, you know what, I can take her. She's like 5'2" and 5'8".
A TV programme just months before the 2019 election campaign hit Corbyn and his supporters hard.
Many British Jews once saw the Labour Party as their natural political home. No longer.
Being a bystander who turns their head the other way is not an option. The time for action is now.
They say they're being pushed out of Labour by a left-wing version of the world's oldest form of racism.
That programme was a disgrace. But it was skillfully put together with a collection of distortions, innuendos. It's the weft and warp of how the press and media work. Take a grain of truth and then erect a whole system of lies around it. And completely shameful.
The Labour leadership's only answer to the media attacks seemed to be to say sorry. Some of Jeremy's closest supporters felt let down.
We kept thinking, Jeremy and John McDonnell, they will see that they really need to stand up to this now. They will understand that this is not, these criticisms are not made in good faith.
He had certain avenues. He could have stood up. He could have made some speeches saying, yes, I oppose anti-Semitism insofar as it exists, but I also oppose the weaponization of anti-Semitism against the left.
And instead of that, we went on the defensive. We try to say that that we're sorry. We're sorry if we've offended people. Well, I think it's okay to say you're sorry if you offend people, but to then go on from there and say we've done something fundamentally wrong, whereas in fact what we really did wrong was not to stand up to all that network of forces that was out to crush the left.
I am critical of how we handled the anti-Semitism thing, because in my view, we didn't. Jeremy was very, very upset by the allegation. Very personally wounded, and it sort of paralysed a political response.
There was a network of different interests working together to basically delegitimise the anti-Zionist struggle. But there was also a coincidence of interest between the Zionist forces in the Labour Party and the right wing of the Labour Party, often but not always the same people. So it was to ensure, firstly, that there was never going to be a Prime Minister in this country who was a supporter of Palestine and the Palestinian interests on the one hand, and secondly, to ensure that there was never a leader of the Labour Party who could become Prime Minister who would be fighting the establishment.